Check out these secret Game Pass games. Just how many problems does Halo Infinite have? And you'll be surprised at which console sold the most units on Black Friday. Let's discuss. So the president and joint CEO of CD Projekt Red has confirmed that a next-gen version of Cyberpunk is coming to us in the first quarter of 2022. So that means anywhere from January 1st through March 31st. They were supposed to release a next-gen native version of Cyberpunk at the end of 2021, but we can assume that because Cyberpunk launched in such a messy state, that they were way more focused on bringing updates to make it playable and make it what it was hyped up to be, rather than focusing on releasing a next-gen version of the game. Now, this is one of the main criticisms of the current generation of gaming consoles, the PS5, the Xbox Series consoles, is that the tech of the old consoles is holding back the new consoles, right? We haven't really seen the true potential of these machines because developers are still making games with the old tech in mind. So hopefully this next generation of consoles, when they release this native next-gen version of Cyberpunk, can really take advantage of that new technology, that new hardware, the solid-state drives, to deliver a really beautiful, smooth experience. It ran really well on the PC when it came out, and even though you can play it on your Series X, you're still running the Xbox One version on your Series X, so that upscale resolution, those new fancy frames that you can be running on your more powerful Series X, is not really happening on the current version of Cyberpunk. Now, I haven't played Cyberpunk personally. I was a big fan of the Witcher series and I was excited for Cyberpunk, but I didn't get it launch, and when it launched, I thought, you know what, I'll just continue to wait because the game is in such a messy, messy, messy state. But it's not uncommon for games nowadays to release, even though Cyberpunk's release was probably the worst in recent memory, it's not uncommon for these games to be released like that, and then as time goes on, the more updates are added, the more they fix it up, it becomes a title that people really, really enjoy. I experienced this personally in The Elder Scrolls Online. I played it in beta, and I played it when it launched back in 2014, and the game was not good. Game was not good, honestly. But fast forward to now, all those updates that they've released, Somerset, Blackwood, all the many others, and it's become a title that not only have a lot of people enjoyed, but a lucrative title for ZeniMax Media. Now, if you are interested in trying out Cyberpunk, here's a hot tip for you. So if you buy it right now, I know it was on sale for Black Friday for $10, but it goes on sale on the Xbox Store for $10 a lot. I've seen it a lot go on sale for that price. And if you buy it now, even if you are wanting the next gen version, if you buy it now for $10 or whenever it goes on sale for $10, when that next gen upgrade comes out, it'll upgrade you for free. So rather than spending $70 on the next gen version of that game, you buy it now for cheap and then it gives you a free upgrade. Now, I finally got everything I needed for my own home setup, and I'm gonna be starting to stream on Twitch at Stay Xbox Ready. Probably gonna be playing a lot of Halo. I'm also on Twitter at Stay Xbox Ready, same thing, and I would greatly appreciate if you gave me a follow there. Halo Infinite multiplayer has been out for about 2 weeks now, and I am having a ball of a time. It's probably the most fun I've had in a good while playing a multiplayer shooter. However, not everyone is as happy as me. So first off, people are kind of upset about the cosmetics, saying that certain attachments are locked to certain armor cores, and the colors are kind of not as customizable as people want. You can't attach a specific color on different parts of your armor and stuff. It all comes as a match set. It's hard to explain if you haven't seen it, I guess. But for me, that's something I don't really care about. When I'm in the middle of a firefight, fighting for my life in a 2v1 situation with nothing but a battle rifle and a couple of frag grenades, the last thing I'm thinking about is, I hope they think my armor's cool, or, man, that guy's armor's really, really cool. But I understand that's a valid criticism because that's just part of modern games right now, and especially free-to-play games. Second, the challenge system is just dumb. Okay, it's just dumb. At first, you know, the challenges were so, so specific. I had a friend who had a challenge that was get X amount of headshots while riding shotgun in the Warthog, and like, that's just way too specific, man. I had one at the beginning where it was get X amount of kills using the plasma cannons on a ghost. And that's not even the most fun way to kill someone using the ghost, at least encourage people to get splatters. Now, I didn't even see I could go 10, 12 games without seeing a ghost. Or, and when I see one, it's just a mad rush to get it, so everyone's trying to get it. And it's just, these challenges are not a natural part of the game. Even the more simpler ones, like get X amount of kills using your sidekick pistol. If I'm playing a bunch of ranked, that's something I would need to go out of my way to complete. I know they've made improvements since then. For example, you complete a challenge every time you play a game, and that's just free experience for you right there, in addition to all the other challenges that they have daily and weekly. Now, I say just get rid of all that, man. Just get rid of it. And award XP based on performance and medals. If you get a Kilimanjaro, you should get a ton of experience for that, because that is an epic feat. And beef up the experience that you would give for medals that people receive that are objective based. They're not a lot, at least in my experience, but they're there. For example, I got a medal for capturing all of the points in strongholds in a single life. So that way people are encouraged to play the objectives, which is kind of becoming a problem. People have been complaining that people are just going for kills and not playing the objective, whether it's an oddball, strongholds, or capture the flag. The most recent problem is that people are mad that there's forced crossplay. So if you're not familiar, when you log on to Halo Infinite multiplayer, you will be playing, whether it's 4v4 and or 8v8 game modes, you will be playing with a mixture of people will play with mouse and keyboard, and people will play with controllers. Now, this has turned out to be a hotly debated topic, with mouse and keyboard players saying that controller aim assist is overpowered, and on the other side saying that a controller player will never be as good as a mouse and keyboard player. Now they're calling for the option to opt out of crossplay completely. And some people are saying that they should just get rid of it altogether. I don't want them to get rid of it altogether, because all of my friends play with mouse and keyboard. I'm the only one that plays with the controller, so I want to be able to keep playing with my friends, whether they play with a mouse and keyboard or controller. I like the inclusivity of that. But the problem is that cheaters have surfaced in Halo Infinite multiplayer already, and that is a problem. I've had my suspicions. I've definitely felt at some times, you know what? I think that guy shot me through a wall. I'm pretty sure that guy shot me through a wall. I can't prove it, but I have a strong, strong suspicion. Now, this is something 343 has to deal with right now, and severely. The longer they allow this problem to go on, the more unmanageable it's going to get. Because if you can cheat willy-nilly on mouse and keyboard on your PC, then that's gonna be a problem, right? They're just gonna be emboldened by that. Now, they already have the option to queue you up with just controller players or just mouse and keyboard players for solo and duo queues. So we already know that's something that is available. So why not roll it out to the 4v4 modes and the 8v8? That's just, and you know, it's not like they don't have the player base to support that either. Just give us the option, it would be nice. But the good news is that 343 has been pretty active in terms of responding to feedback, especially on their official Twitter accounts, the Halo support, and things like that. Now, that's an encouraging sign for us, considering that, you know, the studio is willing to listen to player feedback and implement it swiftly and concisely. So a quick congratulations to the Xbox Series S for being the top console in terms of console units sold this Black Friday, for Black Friday 2021. To the surprise of many, the combined sales of the Xbox Series X and S surpassed that of the PS5 and the Nintendo Switch. Now, the Series S definitely has an edge in overall availability compared to the Series X and the PS5, but I think that's discounting a lot of the things that are great about the Series S. And we know that Xbox just has overall great value right now, with the Series S low price point combined with the Xbox Game Pass. You have access to a ton of games right off the bat, and some additional perks as well. And the real story here for me is that people are mad about it. They're really, really mad about it. People are going on Twitter and getting into fights with people and saying all sorts of crazy stuff because their feelings are hurt that a lot of people bought the Xbox Series S this Black Friday. I can't explain why. Even if you are a diehard PlayStation fan, how does people buying the Series S affect your enjoyment of your own PlayStation console? I don't understand. And how does it make you so upset that you're gonna get into an argument with someone on Twitter? I saw a tweet that said, the only reason why people are buying the Series S is because no one wants it. Again, this is the dumb part of these console wars. Obviously, this is coming from a guy who has an Xbox channel that's quote unquote Team Xbox, but these console wars, it's like, you know, if it's lighthearted and fun, cool, but if it's gonna make you get into an argument with someone over the internet and personally insult them, why? For, like, I don't want PlayStation to stop being PlayStation, right? Even though I love Xbox, I don't want PlayStation to try to copy Xbox. I want them to keep doing what they're doing. I like the games that they're putting out. I enjoy them. Same thing with the Nintendo Switch. But I want Xbox to keep doing what they're doing with the Game Pass, with the integration, with cloud gaming. I like that stuff. So let's just chill. Let's just chill, man. Now, the ability to record your game and capture clips in-game is becoming increasingly important. So for me, personally, I am obviously an Xbox YouTuber, and in the past for my videos, I have tried to capture clips of me gaming, whether it be Halo, Scarlet Nexus, Forza, and share them onto my channel. And it is so-so, okay? So first of all, if you want to get any long clips to just the internal storage of the Xbox, you're gonna be locked in 1080p. And when you're capturing clips in 1080p, I'm gaming at 4K 60fps. I wanna show that off to my followers. I think that'd be really cool. I know it takes up a lot of memory the higher the resolution, but still, it'd be nice to record 4K for longer so I can, like I said, show it off to my viewers, to my followers, and things like that. Also, when I've recorded some clips, there have been some horrific audio artifacts going on in the background, especially when I play them back, the clips that are uploaded to Xbox Live. When I captured a bunch of game footage for Halo, when the multiplayer first came out, there was like, in some clips, a horrible, horrible grinding noise in the background. I don't know what that was about. Other people have reported bugs, trouble syncing, and overall just bad quality clips when they try to record. Now, even if you're not a YouTuber such as myself, this is a feature that is important to gamers, because when you do something really crazy, you want to take that clip and share it for posterity's sake and to show off your awesome game. And from a marketing standpoint, the ability to share high quality gaming clips is great for Microsoft from a marketing standpoint, because it's just showing off how cool your game is and how awesome a time everyone is having playing it. So we know that this is an important feature for Xbox because they've added it straight up on your controller, right? They have the capture button right there because they, clearly it's a priority for them, but there's still work for them to do. So the director of product management had this to say about their continued work in the video capture feature space. I will definitely say that game VR is the one area, the capture and share experience, that I wish we were able to make more progress on this year than we were able to. It is definitely a priority for us. We definitely hear the feedback. We have made some changes, and we have made some improvements to the reliability and the quality of the captures, but we know we still have work to do here. So if you have Game Pass Ultimate, you have access to probably more than you think. So first of all, you have access to PC Game Pass, and you have access to EA Play, which gives you access to a suite of EA games. Now, I know we all have our personal feelings about EA as a company. They have been pretty questionable in the past, but they have some really, really, really awesome games that fall under their umbrella. One of them being It Takes Two, that you can play right now on Game Pass if you have Ultimate. So in order to get access to these games, if you type any of these hidden games into your Xbox app on your PC, they won't show up. You're gonna need to go over to EA Play and link your Xbox account to your EA Play account. You do have to have the separate EA app and search for these hidden games in that app in order to download them, but it will be, like I said, part of your Xbox Ultimate subscription. Now, the more I think about it, the more I'm like, come on, man. You shouldn't need two apps to access games that you are paying for. It should all just be seamlessly integrated with that Xbox app, but for now, this is how it is. Anyway, guys, thanks so much for tuning in. If you're tuning in for the first time, my name is Ray, and we'll see you in the next video.